Hey, it's Kyle here, and welcome back to Kerbal Space Program, where we find ourselves hanging out with a starship in Mun orbit, which is where we left ourselves in the last installment of the Artemis series. In that last video, which you can see in the little card at the top right if you haven't already watched it, we decided to put ourselves just in a standard equatorial orbit of the Mun, as at this point in time there isn't actually a flight plan that describes where and how Artemis 3 and Orion are meant to dock. So we had to make a choice. Do we continue using the equatorial orbit and burn a bucket load of Delta V to put ourselves in that lovely halo orbit, or do we hit the rewind button? Yep, I messed up. So I went and found one of the old quick saves I'd made just after completing my insertion burn to the Mun, and started planning some maneuver nodes to correct our trajectory and put ourselves in a near rectilinear halo orbit. While we're doing these correction burns, let's talk about Artemis 3 and why they're actually using SpaceX's Starship instead of another human landing system. SpaceX won the human landing system contract, however, this is only for the Artemis 3 crewed moon landing. Future landings are expected to be through a competitive, follow-up, recurring services contract. What this means is there will be other options for the landers, but just for now, SpaceX's Starship is the ticket we're riding with. And this means for Artemis 3, they do have to abandon the original plan that was in place, which saw them rendezvous with the Lunar Gateway. So we'll come back to the Lunar Gateway in a future video, but this time around, we will not be visiting what is soon to be humanity's furthest base among the stars. But we will see it on the map screen every time we have to make an orbital adjustment around the Mun. With our new orbit secured, let's head back to the KSC and launch an SLS. Well, that'll certainly blow the doors off your launch tower's elevators. In case you aren't aware of what I'm talking about, the pressure that was generated by the launch of the SLS was actually enough to literally blow the doors off the pad's elevators. After the launch of Artemis 1, NASA's Artemis mission manager Mike Sarafin did a bit of an interview with space.com where he kind of went through all the damage that they'd seen after the launch, considering it was the first time they'd actually flown the rocket, considering how big it is. And surprisingly, there wasn't a lot of damage, but the one thing that did stand out is that the sheer pressure of air generated by the SLS blew open the doors to the elevators. Look at this picture, it's brilliant. So yeah, don't go in an elevator while a rocket's launching, I guess, is the piece of advice for this video. As always, if I mention an article, link will be in the video description if you want to check it out. Anyway, we've gotten to a point now that we've started our ascent, we've done our separation from our solid rocket boosters, and we're about to start heading into circularization territory. So I think it's probably about time I introduce you to who our crew is for this mission. As with my Artemis 2 video, unfortunately we do not know the actual lineups of the crews for the upcoming missions. So these are educated guesses based on how NASA's operated in the past. Give it a couple of years and maybe we can come back and revisit these videos once the launches have happened and find out if I was right on my guesses. And with separation from the SLS and Orion flying free, we might as well start with our first pilot, and that's Jasmine Mokbeli. She is a pilot via the Marines with a Bachelor of Science in Aerospace Engineering with Information Technology and a Master of Science in Aerospace Engineering. Mokbeli earned her wings of gold as a naval aviator before training as a light attack helicopter pilot based out of California. And after several international deployments, she was attached to a medium helicopter squadron before heading to the United States Naval Test Pilot School, executing a variety of test flights. Now, she was selected as an astronaut in 2017 after racking up more than 150 combat missions and 2,000 flight hours in 25 different aircraft. And in March this year, she was assigned as commander of SpaceX's Crew 7 mission to the ISS, which is scheduled to launch in 2023. Next, we're going to talk science with scientist Joseph Acaba, because both Jasmine and Joseph are going to be staying in orbit while our other two crew members head down to the lunar surface. And in Joseph's case, that's got to be a bit of a sucky situation, but when selecting crews, you have to make difficult decisions, and I'm sorry, Joseph. I need your expertise up in orbit to scout out the perfect site for us to set up our future lunar base. Akaba has a Bachelor of Science in Geology along with a Master's in Geology and a Master's in Education. And he worked as a hydrogeologist in California, worked with the US Peace Corps in environmental education awareness in the Dominican Republic. He's been the manager of the Caribbean Marine Research Center in the Bahamas, and he's also taught at a school for 5 years. Selected an astronaut in 2004, Joseph has been on a lot of missions, including as a mission specialist for STS-119, which delivered the final pair of solar array wings to the ISS. He then also flew again on ISS Expedition 31-32 and Expedition 53-54, and has racked up 306 days in space. Now, we'll come back to the rest of our crew shortly, but on screen, we've done a couple of things. Firstly, we've burnt into our Mana orbit, separated from our transfer stage, which has went and dropped off some CubeSats, and then we've started our circularization burn and rendezvous with the Starship lander. And to be honest, I thought this would be a lot more challenging than it was. Yes, there are some orbital mechanics issues here with how the actual orbit works, and you've got to really play around with your maneuver nodes to try and get it to line up correctly because this is going through a different plane. You've got to do inclination changes along with adjustments for ascending and descending nodes, but it's not impossible. It just takes a little bit of patience, which can be frustrating. And it's definitely made me confident that I can continue building the Lunar Gateway without too many issues, at least in the orbital department. While we wait for our Orion spacecraft to rendezvous with our loitering Starship, let's talk a little bit about Artemis 3. Now, Artemis 3 currently plans to land a crew at the moon's south polar region, and they're going to stay there for about a week. It's going to be the first mission to place a woman on the moon, and while there are up to 4 astronauts leaving Earth on board Orion, the surface mission is only going to consist of 2 crew members. Before the Artemis 3 landing, some additional equipment is going to be pre-positioned on the surface, including an unpressurized rover for astronauts to use during their lunar excursions. Now, I forgot to do that, and in my laser-focused attempt to make sure we could actually land Starship on the surface, none of these pre-supply missions have been done, and to be fair... There's not really much need for them in a Kerbal mission, at least not at this stage. We will be introducing the rover on a future mission, and that rover is going to have the capability to be controlled remotely along with driven by astronauts. Now, the reason we are of course heading to the moon's south pole is we're hoping we can find some water ice. And there are several permanently shadowed regions, particularly craters, that could be reached by short little trips on the rover. Now, these trips would be about 5 to 15 kilometers, well within the range of the rover, and it's kind of been suggested that each time the astronauts go out on a moonwalk, one of these expeditions will be undertaken. And NASA's hoping to use these rover exploration trips to figure out if there is a viable location where a lunar base could be established. Back to what's happening on screen, and we've docked with our Starship human landing system and discovered for some reason it had no power. So I transferred some of our electricity from Orion into the batteries of Starship and discovered it was draining it at a very unusual rate while the solar panels, while saying they were actually generating power, were for some reason not dropping that power into the batteries. For those who are wondering, yes, the probe cores and sensors within did have themselves set to hibernate, including during warp, so I'm not quite sure what was draining the battery and why it wasn't charging. It does look like it might have been something to do with a mod, and the issue seemed to resolve itself after I re-verified the install, but this is always the risk we run when we're using this many mods. So with Starship now operational, it was time to organize our crew to be transferred over to it before separating the crafts and heading down to the Mana surface. Which may have you wondering, who on earth is heading down there? Well, I guess it's about time I introduce you to the other half of the crew who I think have a very good chance of being selected as the 2 astronauts NASA picks for our return to the moon's surface. So let's start with our pilot, and it's the incredible, the wonderful, Captain Scott Tingle. Yes, he's got a Bachelor of Science in Mechanical Engineering plus Masters with a specialty in Fluid Mechanics and Propulsion, and he spent 3 years with Aerospace Corporation as part of their propulsion department before joining the Navy and earning his wings. He, as most pilots do, eventually joined Test Pilot School and was an operational test pilot for the FA-18 EF Super Hornet program. He has a mind-boggling 4,500 flight hours in 51 types of aircraft with 750 carrier arrestments and 54 combat missions. So, as you can tell, he knows how to fly a plane. But what about a spacecraft? Well, Tingle was selected as an astronaut in 2009 and was assigned as the flight engineer and US operational segment lead for ISS Expedition 5455, and that was in 2017 and 2018, and he ended up spending 168 days in orbit. Alongside him, we have a woman who has an incredible history within NASA, and that's Stephanie Wilson. She's got a Bachelor of Science in Engineering Science, a Master's of Science in Aerospace Engineering, and was an engineer for the Titan IV rocket. Her postgrad study was sponsored by NASA back in 1990, as she focused on the control and modeling of large, flexible space structures, which would be quite important for the construction of the ISS. She joined JPL as a member of the Attitude and Articulation Control Subsystem Team for the Galileo spacecraft, and then joined NASA officially as an astronaut in 1996 and worked in the astronaut office, Capcom, Mission Control as the prime communicator with the shuttle before working on the space shuttle's main engines. She was assigned to STS-121, STS-120 and STS-131 before returning to work on so many parts of the ISS and its support structure in expert roles. STS-121 in particular was the first flight after the Columbia disaster and delivered equipment and crucial supplies to the ISS for the Destiny Lab. While she's only spent 42 days in space, her wealth of experience is incredible, and you wouldn't want to have any other engineer on board with you, especially considering we're using parts of the space shuttle to build the entire Artemis program. With Scott and Stephanie introduced, we can now continue our descent to the Moon's surface, and we are of course landing at the South Pole. And if there's one thing I'm quite aware of the polar regions of the Moon, they're not exactly what you'd call flat, which is made even more apparent thanks to the beautiful Parallax 2 mod we have installed, which has made the Moon look absolutely incredible. Unfortunately, Starship is very top-heavy, and it's very prone to toppling over even with those landing thrusters that are placed in the black ring that runs around the top half of the craft. But we'll come back to these issues in a moment, because an important piece of Kerbal history is about to unfold. So as we head back up to Rendezvous with Orion, let's talk about the challenges that Starship as a lander presents. And I gotta be honest, I'm not a fan, and this is purely a design issue in two fronts. Firstly, and I think this is probably the biggest issue with the craft that I've created, the landing legs are just not good enough. In this case, we have of course chose aesthetic over usability because we wanted it to look like Starship's human landing system as much as possible, but they're just not big enough for what we need. The second part of this equation is about Starship itself. As a craft, it's very heavy, and it's going to be carrying a massive amount of fuel because the principle behind it and why it's been refueled in low Earth orbit is so that it can be reused multiple times before needing another fueling run. That means each time you land, you are taking all that excess fuel down to the lunar surface and then back up into orbit. And that's a lot of extra fuel to be carrying, and it's also going to lift the center of mass higher in the vehicle, thus why you will have a bit of rocking unless those legs are perfect.
Now, this is not to say that Starship as a landing system in general won't work. What I'm saying is the craft that I've built does not. And with that in mind, I'm incredibly reluctant to share this actual craft file because, to be quite blunt, it's not a good design. I have managed to make it work, sure. Has it served its purpose for this video? Absolutely, but as a craft that I can say, yeah, go and download and use in Kerbal? No, it's awful, and you honestly, with the amount of issues I've had with it, no, I would highly recommend against it. Now, on the opposite side of the scale, I can say that I'm actually very happy with how Orion and SLS and the interim cryogenic stage operate as far as the SLS system goes. So if you're looking to recreate the SLS, you can find those files over on Kerbal X. I'll put a link in the video description. But let's return to the mission at hand, because we're not quite done just yet. We have been successful in ascending from the lunar surface, putting ourselves into a circularized Mun orbit, and then arranging a rendezvous with the awaiting Orion spacecraft. From there, of course, we had to transfer our crew back over before undocking, before our journey to return back to Kerbin could finally get underway. A departure burn, followed by another retrograde burn once we've left the Mun Sphere of Influence, let us get our periapsis down to 35,000 meters. We're going to be coming in very fast and very toasty. So the final separation of the mission removes our trunk section of the craft, and we're going to re-enter Kerbin's atmosphere with a very steep ballistic profile. I also made some minor adjustments to see if I could get us to land near the KSC, because our trajectory was actually very close to the peninsula. And would you look at that, it actually worked, and I wasn't even using the mod trajectories this time. On the note of mods, my install has changed a little bit between the last video and this video, mostly because someone mentioned restock a couple of videos back, and I thought, you know what, why not? Let's put it on there and see how it looks. And I do quite like how they've reimagined the skins of all of the original parts. Alongside that, I did mention that I've got Parallax 2 installed, which is why the moon looks absolutely phenomenal, and also why we've got palm trees on Kerbin near the KSC. And that brings this video to its end. Thank you so much for watching. Probably worth noting, and please let me know in the comments section below, my monitor died. So I'm actually using a backup monitor, which is not color calibrated at all for videos. So if this looked a little bit washed out or a little bit weird, please let me know. I do have a new one on the way. But other than that, this was a lot of fun to undertake. I'm probably now going to work on the back catalog that I have filmed of the career mode and try and get that out of the way. Hopefully, now that things are quieting down and we're heading into the festive season, I'll have a bit more chance to sit down and make a bit more content. So until next time, thank you so much for watching, and I'll catch you on the next pass.